So last time we did this stable pairs theory for smooth K3 fibrations for irreducible curve class. Now in irreducible curve classes, again our fibration acts to C is a smooth K3 fibration onto a smooth projective curve. So we allow the curve classes for our stable pairs to be in the vertical direction. So these are integral homology classes along the fibers. So these are curve classes which come from the fibers to be reducible. And from that P of C, is a connected, it's a connected component, but it's an isolated active component. It means that the curve class, the stable pair is just supported on one fiber. And this is the type 2 component of P and X beta, which is the modulus of stable pairs, like O of X to F, where the Euler characteristic of F was supposed to be equal to N, fundamental homology class of support of F was supposed to be equal to beta. Okay? And so F is supported on one of those curves with that class. This means that we have an isomorphism P of C isomorphic to PMN as gamma. So this type 2 component being an isolated component means this, where beta is equal to I lower star of gamma, and I from S to into X is an inclusion of a fiber. It's an inclusion of a fiber. The fiber on which the stable pair is supported. Hence, here, gamma is no longer needed to be irreducible. Okay, but we always assume that H1 of L is equal to 0 for any line bundle L on S such that first string class of that line bundle is equal to beta. Beta is the realization of gamma after being pushed forward into the X. So there is a lemma that I would put in here without proof. Lemma, this would be number 11. Suppose that gamma satisfies this, let's call this condition something. This condition, let's call it star. Satisfies condition star. Then the dimension of the each irreducible components, each irreducible component of P of N S gamma, this is a moduli space, does not exceed this number, I call it nu, n plus gamma is n plus 1. Okay, so I mean, this is some lemma, it's a some calculation, I don't think there is any point to actually prove it in here, but this particular bound on dimension will help me later to actually to prove something. So now by...
I'm sorry to interrupt you. I just want to make sure. I think you already explained and discussed either last or two lectures ago that in your case, even in this case, your F, the support F scheme theoretically is really containing a fiber rather than fatten. You already explained that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes. One lecture ago, I explained that, yes. Yes, it's in the video. So now, by Kuhl and Thomas, this is Martin Kuhl and Richard Thomas, their result in 2014, the component which is P of N of S gamma is equipped with perfect obstruction theory . So this is their result. They have a paper reduced the stable pairing variance, something like that. And this is where they discuss this kind of obstruction theory. Given by, we will call this obstruction theory V dot, and it is R hom. So we can put R pi V over star of R hom. Let's call this thing G, if you like, I dot omega pi A PC L2 PC. What is this? I mean, on this moduli space, there is a universal stable pair. So on this moduli space of P of N S gamma, there is a universal moduli, there is a universal stable pair which looks like this. So that's the sheaf G, and that's the complex in the derived category that represents this two-term complex. And this is the natural perfect obstruction theory of this particular component. You see, when we have isolated components, isolated type 2 components, our obstruction theory is given by these. When we have non-isolated components, fiber-wise, our obstruction theory is given by this. So this is fiber-type obstruction theory. So this is their construction. Note that the obstruction theory, I mean, this is...
Is that a typo? Your two R's? What is the two RRs?
Two R's? Where?
Is G equal to direct R and then one is the direct R, the
R
other?
R pi over star of R hum.
Oh, R pi over star R hum. What is that? R hum is already a derived
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, and then you send it down.
I'll send it down.
Yeah, R pi over star of R hum.
Oh, why is it R pi over?
Okay. Note that the obstruction sheaf H1 of G dot dual. Because this is the definition of obstruction shape. I mean, if you have some obstruction theory, H1 of the dual of that obstruction theory in the draft category is the sheaf of G dot, an obstruction sheaf H1 G dot of G dot. Of G dot admits a surjection. A surjection to the trivial factor, trivial vector bundle, if you like, trivial vector bundle given by natural surjection. The following one, so harm I dot G shifted by 1 goes on to X2 G and G, which surjects all the way down onto C. This is a point-wise thing. If you look at the fiber of this R-harm, if you drive dualize this whole G dot, you look at the fiber of G dot over a point in the marginalized space, you will get some complex on the actual surface S. And then you can take the cohomologies and then you will see these harms are on the surface. Okay? So this is a homomorphism in the Dirac category of the surface. This one. Harm sheaf. And then you will get this group. And then onto that. And the way you can see this kind of thing, why is that true? You can look at this guy and apply harm G to this thing. So if you apply R harm blank G tilde to this thing, you will see R harm I dot comma G, and the next one is R harm GG. But the change in the shifting. The shifted by 1. So you can see that this you will get. Alright, and so okay, and at the fiber of I dot over S given by O of S to G, and Gieseker. So the second morphism above, basically this one, the second morphism is the dual to C times identity, which sits inside harm GG. And why is that so? Because these are stable sheaves and they are simple objects in their own algebra, and C times identity basically sits inside here. And if you dualize this thing, the dual serdual of this thing is, this is a K3 fibration, so the canonical bundle is trivial. Serdual of this thing is X2, and it suggests onto C. So this surjection is the dual of this injection. So that's why you will get that. And the reason I put it like this, this is the obstruction for deformations of two-term complexes like this. What is this thing? This is really, maybe I shouldn't have put 1 in here, but of course it's obvious for you guys that this is just x1 I dot comma g. In a sense, it gets mapped to x2. x1 I dot comma g is the obstruction to deforming two-term complexes like this. And another thing, maybe this is useful, if you have looked at cut schemes and so on, the obstruction theory of cut schemes, which parameterizes quotient sheaves, is always given by homomorphisms from quotient to kernel. This is a direct categorical version of that. You can think of this guy as the quotient and this guy as the kernel. I'm not saying this is that, of course, but kind of similar. Okay. So there is definitely some nice similarity. So by removing the trivial factor that we got there, and removing the trivial factor, all of PC, I mean, this C tells us that there is some factor of O of PC which fiberwise over every point of the modulus, which gives us a C. So by removing this trivial factor O of PC from the subtraction theory G dot, K and T, Kuhl and Thomas, construct virtual cycle. Which is Pn as gamma reduced, or you can put it virtual reduced, and it sits inside the Chow homology of Pn as gamma, which has exactly the dimension which I gave you in the previous lemma as the bound, as the upper bound. This is that dimension. It was n plus gamma squared plus 1. This new is defined in lemma 11, which I just gave. And removing the factor of OBC is kind of also not so hard. I mean, there's a map from G dot to its cohomology. So there's a map from G dot to, okay, I mean, you can dualize if you want. There's a map from G dot dual onto H1 of G dot dual shifted by minus 1. We take the cone of that. And then, okay, from here to all the way to O. Fiberwise, this gives you this C. All the way to O. You get a composite map, you take the cone of that, and that gives you a new complex. And then you need to prove that that new complex, you can call it G dot reduced or something, that is this complex minus that trivial factor of O, that reduced complex, you need to prove it does satisfy the conditions of being a perfect abstraction. And this is what you will get. And why is it that we are removing factors of O? Imagine that there is a trivial factor inside the obstruction sheaf of your moduli space. Then you will get zero for your invariant. If your obstruction bundle, for example, has a trivial piece inside it, something plus some trivial piece, for example, then we take the Euler class of that thing, Euler class of the trivial bundle is zero. And so you will get zero. This way you can actually, for example, see that Donaldson-Thomas invariants of K3 surfaces give you zero. But then you can reduce it. You can remove that trivial factor, and you can reduce it, and then you will get non-zero reduced invariants. Very similar to vanishing of Gramma within the invariants of holomorphic symplectic things like K3.
So that lower index, RET, refer to this process of removing the trivial factor.
Yes, that's right. That's right. The reduced classes obtained by some G dot reduced, if you like, which you obtain by removing the trivial factor O from your definition obstruction complex. Okay. There's no problem with getting zero for invariants, but it's maybe not as exciting. So. New again was n plus gamma squared plus 1, which was the upper bound for our moduli space. Now let B dot be the obstruction theory of this moduli space P, restricted to its connected component here. See? We define, so now I would like to do type 1 components. So isolated type 2 components, we know that they have social abstraction theory, we can calculate them. Now type 1 components, we define the following element. Following element in the K group. So what do I want to call this thing? I will call this thing V, which is minus E dot dual plus G dot dual plus K group associated to the structure sheaf. So this is, I mean, if you have sheaves or complex of sheaves and so on in the derived category of some space, obviously then there is this weaker, you can weaken that thing and that gives you some element of the K group. And so we look at that element in the K group. So for now, you just don't know what this is, where is this coming from. Let's just define an element in the K group of the marginalized space, given this way. But I will tell you why, where is this coming from right now. Then V is of constant rank. So now there is this proposition 12 it is, which tells us that the obstruction, the virtual cycle induced by the obstruction theory of the whole marginalized space over the connected type 1 components is given by C, so let's see, I call that thing nu, C nu of V capped with P and S gamma reduced. What are these things even mean? In the irreducible curve, in the curve class case, I proved for you last time, a statement about virtual cycle, the relation between virtual cycle of our obstruction theory on the threefold for a K3 fibration, and the virtual cycle, the fiber-wise virtual cycle. We knew that the stable pairs inside the threefold, their deformation has contributions coming from the fiber-wise deformations and somehow movements, some deformations of those curves which are induced by the movement of the infinitesimal movement of the fibers. So last time for irreducible curve classes, we had a statement very similar to this thing. We had some virtual cycle of the threefold theory for the K3 partition was the equal to virtual cycle of the twofold theory plus extra contributions. Just turns out that we cannot produce the same proof. If you look at the last lecture in the video, turns out that you cannot regenerate the same proof for reducible curve classes. So we do it abstractly by looking at K groups this time. And somehow a trick, we are trying to cook up a trick to obtain a similar statement to what we had last time. So,
I have a naive question. So, for these two type 1 and type 2 connected components, you do this in two different ways. So, how do you know that they, I mean, you have freedom, right? You have choice to do this.
Yes.
But how do you know that they are, in some sense, fit together?
Hmm?
I mean, how do you know that you are defining one kind of invariant? I'm not sure how to
explain. We put them all together.
Good question. Perhaps someone else is clever enough to cook up another for either type 1 or type 2 components. Another way to to construct a meaningful
definitely.
So how do you know the...
This is all depending on the choice of obstruction theory. That's this is always these invariants. These are deformation invariants, but they depend on the choice of obstruction theory.
But I'm curious, in the end, if you want to build up some generating function.
So you're asking a different question. You're asking, we have type 2 components. Let me tell you what you're asking. If it is not, then you can correct. You're asking that our moduli space has connected components. Some of these are type 1, some of these are type 2. Type 2 means that the sheaf is a scheme theoretically supported on the fiber, and the moduli space is just the fiber-wise moduli space of stable curves. Type 1 means that the sheaf can have thickenings outside of the fiber. Okay. We calculate the invariance of type 1, and we calculate the invariance of type 2 using different obstruction theories. How do we put them all together? The nodal lattice numbers actually tell you how to put them all together. First of all, it's not that these two type 1 and type 2 are completely irrelevant. Type 2 isolated components, the virtual cycle of your moduli space for the threefold even is just equal to the virtual cycle of the fiber. In the type 1 component, the virtual cycle is related to the virtual cycle of the fiber. There must be, after all, some number that tells you somehow those extra contributions induced by the movement of the surface inside the threefold. And those are captured here. So if you ask me what is the nodal lattice number for an isolated component, I can think about, forget about the stable pair theory and do curves theory. I have a K3 fibration, I fix the curve class, all right, and I want this class to be 1-1. Now in the nodal lattice moduli of hydrostructures of this whole fibration, you could have situations where for this particular curve class you can find them on one of the fibers and that's it. And the curve doesn't deform as a 1-1 class. Only on that very fiber it is a 1-1 class, right? The nodal lattice number for that one gives you 1. And the nodal lattice number for the ones that curve still has deformations and still remains as a 1-1 class is some number. So you see that some number, which is different than 1, is captured here. And that 1 is captured by the fact that the fiber-wise moduli space already automatically tells you that this number is 1.
So the details I have to digest myself.
Yeah.
But at least
so when you put them, when you put them all,
these two.
Exactly. When you put them all together, and your generating function will be invariance of the fiber-wise moduli space times 1 for the isolated components plus invariance of the fiber-wise moduli space times some numbers, which tell you about these connected components.
These I have to digest.
But yeah, and if you look at the previous lectures or look at the paper, the obstruction theories E dot and G dot are related by, now this will tell you what is this element of the K through K group, where is that coming from, I dot F is related to R of I dot shifted by 1, and that goes to R of F O X times P shifted by 2. And R I dot SG goes to R I dot F, and that goes to R G of SG. All of these things are pushed forward down I prime I prime. And this notation pi and pi prime, I defined it last time. So we have x times the moduli space this was pi of x, this was pi of p, and inside x you have this surface, the fiber, so this defines some universal divisor inside the product, and this map we call it pi prime. In this map, so to speak, in this setup we call it pi. And this is what we have, and this is the trace free part. And if you want to know how to obtain this exact triangle, you just need to, for this one, you just need to look at I dot O, X, P, and F. This is the universal exact triangle. And you can apply R hom I dot to this thing. If you apply R hom I dot to this universal triangle, let's start from F. R hom I dot F goes to R hom I dot shifted by 1. And then there's a trick in here. And then it goes to R hom I dot O. Okay? So this will not be R hom F O. So what happens here? What does it happen? So maybe I do it at least for one of them, because I don't want to leave mystery in what I'm writing. So if I apply what I said, R hom I dot blank to I dot goes to O goes to F, I will get R hom I dot F goes to R hom I dot shifted by 1. Then it goes to R hom I dot O shifted also by 1. Now I would like to, it is very important and crucial that I would like to take a factor of O out of this. In here. And so I need to subtract off, first of all, by the fact that the stable pairs are stable objects, we know that there is some O that gets inside here, is injected inside here. So this is some R pi over star of O. So let me write it down. Do I have it? I hope that, because I don't want to, there is a shifting that I need to be careful about. Yeah, so the way I have written it is like, there is some factor, something like that, I pi over star of O shifted by 1. And what does this mean? This means R hom O comma O. R hom O comma O. And why do I have a map from R hom O comma O to R hom I dot O? Because to the same exact triangle, you could have applied R hom blank O to this thing. You see, you could have applied R hom blank O to this in the shifted by 1 level. This R hom O O shifted by 1, gets mapped to R hom I dot comma O, shifted by 1. And here, the cone of that, the next one, if I go vertically, will be R hom F O shifted by 2. Now you see, this is telling you that I can take the cone of this row by the acyclic complex in the first row, I can take the cone. If I take the cone, of this map, which is which we can easily see what it is by applying R hom comma O to this thing, is R hom F O 2. And what is the cone of this map? This is the definition of trace free R hom. So this comes in here. R hom I dot shifted by 1 by trace free part this time. And well, so this is a messy picture. So now, this is an acyclic thing. And what is the cone of this by 0? It's itself. So this is how you get this exact triangle. So nothing in here is really mysterious. I mean, all of that you need to see precisely, concretely. So you will get this. And then how do you get this one? the relation between stable pair invariant on the threefold and the stable pair invariant on the surface. So this we also had. So we had I dot, which was going to O and F. But this F was the push forward of the G. Last time we saw that. And we also had I dot S that goes to O of S and G. This is O of X and this is O of S. And the way that we obtained this guy was by pulling back. So if you pull back this I dot of X, let's call it, and I dot of S. So there is this relationship. So pull back, derived pull back of Li upper star of I dot of F gets mapped to I dot of S, and it has a something that sits in here, which is G of S shifted by nothing, just G of S. G twisted by the surface. And we also saw this one. We also saw, I discussed this last time. And now you can apply, basically you can apply Aarhus G to this, blank G. And you will get what we have in here. You will get Aarhus I dot of S comma G. You will get Aarhus from the draft pullback of I dot of F, I dot of X, to G, but then by the left adjointness, property of the left drive pullback and the right drive push forward, that is just I dot F, that produces for you I dot F, and then you will get R hum GS goes to G, like what that happened. So okay, why are these two triangles, one and two, why are they interesting and important? Because the stable pair invariants in the level of threefold are given by an object, by a monster like this. And the stable pair invariants in the fibers are given, they have the obstruction theory given by this. This is your G dot. This is your E dot. And okay, how do you want to connect them to each other, you see? This is why I'm defining some elements in the K group. So it's like, you see, let's just do some very simple and naive kind of game. Okay, this is an exact triangle in the draft category. K group of this guy minus this guy plus this guy is equal to zero. This is also an object in the draft category. K group of this guy minus K group of this guy plus K group of this guy is equal to zero. Now you have two relations. And in between which, these two things are in common. So you will get the relation between K group of this guy, K group of G, and O of PC. That's what we get. So that's how we are relating these things. The reason we are doing this is because in the level of obstruction sheaves, I could take homologies and so on and basically find a relation between obstruction bundle of this guy and the obstruction bundle of the fiber was modified space. But I couldn't work it out because these things, they have co-kernels and the co-kernel jumps in dimension and things like that for reducible kernel classes. So I needed to use K theory, K groups instead. And there are plenty of literature, especially the work of Kapranov and Chuk and Fantanin, where they tell you how to construct virtual cycles using K-theory. Elements on the K-group.
The construction of virtual cycles is somewhere on stack or on scheme or on?
On a DG scheme.
DG scheme.
Differentially graded scheme. So basically they give you a model, a K-theoretic model for the virtual structure sheaf, which was conjectured by Kansas. Or a DG skin, differentially graded skin. This is very similar in flavor to that. Very similar. example, there is a way of constructing virtual cycles for non-commutative moduli spaces that way, actually. Yeah.
When does such moduli space occur?
Where does it occur? I mean, when your objects, your sheaves and so on, there are sheaves, coherent sheaves over non-commutative algebra. Like in the context of non-commutative resolutions and things like that. Anyway, so now so P dot is some two-term complex of vector bundles, So it has some global Loper-free resolution, and this is also something like that, and then there are K groups are given by group of E0 minus K group of E1 and K group of G0 minus K group of G1. So we define some object V prime as E1 minus E0 minus G1 minus G0 plus G0, or if you like, write it like this. Okay, and then this object that I just defined before, V, is the V prime that I defined in here plus OPC. So then, by the above two exact triangles that I defined over there, relating the K group of E dot and G dot, each of one of which are E0 minus E1, G0 minus G1, the fiber of V prime over OX to G, which is a point in this connected component, is given by Euler characteristic of G minus relative Euler characteristic of G with respect to itself, relative Euler form of G with respect to itself. And so now we can just do the calculation. So then that implies that P of C E dot virtual is equal to the total churn class of E1 minus E0 capped with Fulton canonical class of P of C, trace free, and the degree zero part, I mean, and the degree zero part of this cycle. And then that is equal to full churn class of this object V that I defined. It's just a calculation. You just need to sit down and just see via the relations between the K group how to obtain this. Capped with full canonical class of Pn S gamma. And you're still looking at a degree zero part of the cycle that we get. And this is telling us that PLS gamma virtual itself also is C of G1 G0 C of F. I will tell you something about what am I writing in here, so don't worry. that. So there is a relation between virtual cycle and this object Fulton canonical class of a space. If you have some space, you can take this as a definition of the virtual cycle. The virtual cycle of the space is given by this element in the Cha homology, which is called Fulton canonical class of the space, times the top term class of the K group given by the obstruction theory. So your space is equipped with E dot, the two vector bundles, the deformation bundle and the obstruction bundle, E1 and E0. And the Fulton canonical class of the space capped with the top term class of the K group associated to the obstruction theory gives you the virtual cycle if you restrict to the appropriate degree, which is the virtual dimension of your modular space. You're in a situation that the virtual dimension of our modular space is zero, so that's that. Then basically going from here to here is just doing algebra calculations. What does that mean? Now instead of E1 minus E0, I have a formula for it, which is here. E1, E0, G1, and G0 are related to this K group and the V that I defined before. So I just put everything in here. So this is rewriting that expression using the relation I had. So okay, take this as one of the relations. This is relation one. Now you have also a second relation, which is fiber-wise moduli space itself has an obstruction theory, G dot. And again, using the definition of the virtual cycle, the Fulton canonical class of that fiber-wise moduli space times the total term class of the K group associated to obstruction theory gives you the virtual cycle. So this is relation two. And because you're putting total churn class in here, I mean, that's why we need to look at, I mean, these give you class of things in all classes, in all degrees, and we want to just take the part of the thing, that the expression that we get in here, which sits inside expected dimension of the modular space. And I just wrote for you a proof from Poulin Thomas that the expected and the virtual dimension of that fiber-wise modular space is given by this nu, which for us, nu is equal to n plus gamma squared plus 1 for a reducible curve class gamma and for some polycharacteristic m. So you have two relations. And via these two relations, you can relate virtual cycle of the threefold obstruction theory to virtual cycle of twofold obstruction theory, fiber-wise obstruction theory, using K-theory. This is the very kind of what is happening here. And so anyway, so we then relate P C and E dot virtual to Pn as gamma reduced using 1 and this is the proof. Okay, so that was for the reducible curve classes. And last time in my lecture, I wrote something and I said that a part of the proof that relates the threefold virtual cycle to the twofold virtual cycle doesn't work and why it doesn't work. So if you don't remember, please go back to the previous lecture, and that tells you why I'm using this K-theoretical approach. Okay, so that is the end of the reducible curve classes for smooth fibrations. Now, in the remaining half an hour, I will tell you about nodal fibrations. But the good news in here is that we have already done nodal fibrations for sheaf invariants. So a lot of the machinery I'm going to skip because we have seen it before. stable pairs on nodal K3 fibrations. So now X pi X to C with K3 fibers is called nodal. It's called nodal if the singularities of the vibration pi are at worst ordinary double point singularities. ODB. Again, similar to what we discussed before, if I give you a K3 fibrations with singularities in the fibers where the singularity type is rational double point singularity, our analyses carry over there because you can always deform a rational double point singularity to ordinary double point singularity. And all of the invariants I'm discussing in these lectures, these are deformation invariants. So they don't care. So if you prove a statement for nodal fibration with ODP singularity, you have also proved the same statement for rational double point singularity. Because these are deformation invariants. So that's why we can assume this instead of RDP.
Sorry, I forgot. Which one is A1 singular? Which one is A1 singular?
Yeah, this could be a mystery.
Then what is the rational double point?
I mean, you have all of the other ones, right? I mean, you have all of the classification of singularities, all of the double point singularities given by the diagrams, right?
This is A1.
Yeah. So you have that, and an example. If you let X inside P3 times P1, be a generic hyperplane section of degree 4-2, and then this pi, let the pi be the map, the canonical map from natural map from X, which is sitting inside here, onto the base P1. That's a nodal K3 fibration. Okay. So now, again, like before, similar to before, we pass for any curve class, vertical curve class, if you like. Call it vertical curve class. We can define the stable perivariance. Okay, and how do you want to calculate it? You need to use degeneration technique of Junli and Bausen-Wu. Basically, you find a relationship. The goal is to calculate this number for a nodal K3 fibration by relating our nodal K3 fibration to a smooth K3 fibration using degeneration technique. Okay. And we did this already for sheaves, so same exact procedure. So Let me remind you of conical transition. Let S1 plus K in X and C1 be CK prime inside C. So you have this X onto C nodal fibration are the singular points in the fibers of X, and the points on C over which fibers have singularities. Points on C over which fibers have singularities respectively. So these are these points, and these are these points. So you have a K3 fibration. This is my pictorial. We are seeing it. So you have S1 all the way S of K. And you have points on the base curve. We will call them C1 onto all the way onto C of K prime. This is a picture. Obviously, you have finitely many SIs, and you have finitely many CJs. Because the nodal fibration means only finitely many of the fiber exhibit singularity. Okay. By our assumption, each SI in X is an ODP. For any I. Okay. Again, we have this fact that if K prime is even number, even, then define C0 equal to C1. If K prime is odd number, then let C0 be an arbitrary point of this curve C, distinct from C1 to C of K prime. We want even number of points. We want to construct a double cover. Okay, let E be from C tilde onto C be the double cover of C ramified over C0 to C of K prime. Okay. So I think, at least for people in the CMSA, for example, this construction of conical transition should be very, very already familiar. So you construct a double cover of the base curve, and it can be seen that the lift x0 given by pullback of x via this double cover map is a threefold with conical singularities. Tilde onto C, it's a 2-to-1 cover ramified over those even number of points, and this is your original X, threefold with the ordinary dog point singularities along the fibers, and this is the map epsilon. And then you look at the final product for the pullback, you lift it up in here. And this is a new threefold with conifold singularities along the fibers. And you can actually see it. So write down equations like T square, and you will see the type of singularity becomes a conifold singularity. And so therefore you can resolve something with conifold singularities along the fiber, you can just resolve it. So let's now x tilde, let h from x tilde on for x be, it's a small resolution, x0 be it's a small resolution. If you have something with conifold singularities, you can small resolve it and get something smooth with exceptional non-singular rational curves. Non-singular rational curves. To each one of those SIs, so this one has SIs in the fiber, which are ordering the all-point singularity, then pullback of SI gives you something inside here. You can call them, so SIs are points inside here, pullback of SIs are conifold points inside here, and to each one you will get this -1, -1 thing inside the small resolution. -1, -1 term. So those are non-singular rational curves. So, and I tilde from x tilde to c tilde to the double cover induced morphism. So what is the diagram? Again, we did c tilde, double cover of c. We have x in here. We have x0 in here, which is the pullback. And then this is epsilon, this is the map epsilon, this is the map pi of our fibration. And then we resolve this thing, a small resolve it, we call that thing x tilde. We call this map h, and we call the induced map pi tilde. Okay? So, you start it from here, we pass through a conifold, a threefold with conifold singularity, and we ended up with something totally smooth, even along the fibers. So we conifold transited. We pass through a conifold singularity. This is the conifold transition. Now, we would like to relate this guy and this guy. There are different geometries, but you can relate their invariants to each other via the generation technique of Julie. Otherwise, there are some literature about what happens to the DT invariants from when you go from here to here, when you go from here to here. That doesn't work. But there is more exciting features to the geometry of this small resolution and this guy, actually. There are more kind of clever things you can do to relate the two. And I'm going to repeat that again. We did this over the sheaf theory over K3 fibrations. That's why I will be very concise so that I can finish on time. So, what we can do, we can repeat the procedure to relate the theory of x tilde and x. Via degeneration. We can repeat this process by doing the following. So let construct a double cover CT 2 to 1 cover of C ramified over ramified over K plus 2 times K over 2. So my notation K over 2 is equal to 0 if K is even and K over 2 is equal to 1 over 2 if K is odd. Okay. So let's construct a ramified over this one, be a double cover. Double cover of C ramified over these, ramified over many, K over many generic forms. Of C. So what is it we are doing? We have this K3 fibration with nodal singularities, and we have these C1 to C of K prime. These are the special points of the base curve, and to each one of these things I can infinitesimally think about C1 of t, or here Ck prime of t, generic points of the base curve, and I can also construct a rather different ramified path. And then I can pull back exactly like threefold, like what I did there, via this ramified path. If I do that, so I will get a similar diagram, C of t goes to C, this is x, and this is x of t. And this diagram commutes. So x of t, by definition, again, is the pullback of the threefold. This time around, along the double cover of the base curve, ramified on the generic points of the base curve. So basically, you can see the reason I call it the t as time goes to zero, this threefold approaches this threefold. So this is how you can relate them by degenerations. And so then from here, let me see. So via degeneration, there exist two degenerating families. One of them is over A1. You need to be looking at the lecture on K3 fibrations and sheaves. So look at lecture on two-dimensional sheaves and nodal K3 fibrations. I discussed these two degenerations, so I wouldn't repeat all of those constructions. So we had two families where the generic fiber of one family was x tilde, and it was being degenerated into something I called y union d1 to dk, something called p1. And the other one was xt, degenerated to, again, same space, d1 to dk, and this was t2. And for notation, please look at those, that lecture. And here D, the I's are isomorphic to P1 times P1. So now if you do, if you have this, then basically the Julie's degeneration technique tells you that the DT invariants or the PT invariants of the generic member of this family are equal to product of relative PT invariants of this guy with respect to this and this guy with respect to this. Same as here, DT generating, PT generating series of the generic fiber is the product of two relative PT generating series here. But the, as a result of the construction, these pieces have the same varieties associated to them with the same relative divisors. So this is how you can relate PT of this to PT of this. First of all, to a special fiber, then to this guy, then back to this. Okay, so then exactly like last time, two, three lectures ago, when we were doing the sheaf theoretic analog of this. So I will just write down for you what you will get instead. So here is what you will get. The degeneration formula and by the way, the relative PT invariance again means that maybe I write this thing. Relative PT stable pair of WF, so relative to some divisor, relative to divisor D. If W is a threefold, that means that tor 1 O of WF structure sheaf of that divisor needs to be equal to 0. It's always the support of the algebraic object that represents what we are trying to count. That needs to be normal to that relative divisor. In the case of sheaves, we didn't have a section like that. And, well, we just had a sheaf OD. In the case of the stable pair, it's this part of the stable pair that needs to be normal to the divisor. So if someone asks you over the relative modulized base of the stable pair, so for example, PT of this guy is related to PTY relative to D. It means that there is some bizarre modulized base of the stable pairs on this threefold where the sheaves of the stable pairs, they are normal to the relative divisor. If then, if you can construct that much like this, which Zhu Li actually did with a lot of work, okay, that relative construction, then there is a map from relative modulized space to the modulized space of stable pairs on this D. And if we want to have a picture about this, so this is, let's say, Y. So you have degenerated your variety X tilde. This is your variety X tilde. You have degenerated that to a normal crossing like this. You have called a piece Y, and you have called a piece Y1. And we have this D in the middle. And your stable pairs behave very similar to Gramov-Witten invariants. Basically, their support intersects transversely with the divisor. So this algebraic condition actually guarantees that this can happen. And then if someone asks you what is the map from PT modulized space of relative stable pairs on Y, basically means the stable pairs on Y relative to this divisor, to some modulized space on D. What is it? It's just a restriction map. On D, you will see Hilbertism of points. In the lecture I gave about sheaves with two-dimensional support, these are sheaves with one-dimensional support. Before I had sheaves with two-dimensional support, and the normality told me that over here I'm looking at curves. So that modulized space was a different modulized space. It was modulized space of sheaves supported on curves on that divisor. And that was Mukai's modulized space. some relative compactified Jacobian of some linear system of curves on this divisor. The stable Paris theory, on the other hand, is talking about sheaves with section where the sheaf is supported on a curve. Relativity in here is the same, but difference in geometry tells you that over here you will get a different modulus viscosity on the divisor. Relative, so just the Hilberts of points. Anyway, so this is just a picture. And so degeneration formula gives us the following. So dt of x tilde will be summing over pt of y with respect to d, some combinatorial coefficient. We should be looking at the paper, some combinatorial coefficient, then times pt of p1 relative to d. Same in here, pt of xt, and this is summing over compatibilities. So again, I'm summing over compatibility relations in here, and this gives me again pt y over d. Actually, same exact coefficient pt of p2 on d. So if you can see the connection between these two, then because these two pt moduli spaces are the same, then you have found the connection between these two. Okay. And then there is also something that actually this turns out to be equal to 1. So this is equal to 1. This doesn't contribute. Some dimension argument actually tells you that this guy does not contribute. And so eventually, my last thing. So there is also something that you can do. So you can see that pt of x tilde and pt of x are completely related to each other. But then xt is the pullback of the threefold via the ramified double cover of the base curve along some generic points of the curve. You would like to know how is this related to pt of the actual k threefold with the ordinary double point singularities along the fibers. You need to relate that. And so this is the relation. So using the second generation, we can see that pt of x t is related to basically pt of x summing over compatibility. So what does this mean? We can take the base curve, degenerate it into a normal crossing, break the base curve into two pieces, and you have some K3 fibration in here. That's your x, xt. And what does that degeneration tell you? That this degenerates into a normal crossing of a copy of x and another copy of x connected to each other along this K3 surface, s. So you will get x and glued to x along the K3 surface. This is the surgery operation that also degenerations and symplectic geometers actually do this thing a lot. Actually, these days with the proof of the, which is completely, I think, in my opinion, not really succeeding, I don't know, I shouldn't say that, but people are trying to use degenerations and so on to prove correspondence between Foucault categories and derived category for the homological mirror symmetric conjecture. And they use a lot of these things. Symplectic geometers are very familiar with this degeneration. Okay. So you can take the base curve of x and break it into two pieces, connect it over a point, and that tells you a degeneration of original threefold to two copies of x, glued along K3 surfaces. And so for that reason, you can actually see that this guy is related to x, relative to s. And so via this, I can relate. Now, so far I have related this to this, and this to this also is related there. So this can be related to the original threefold. Let me write down the last formula. Here is a theorem. Epsilon tilde star pt of x divided by pt of x h is equal to pt of x squared. And pt of x in here, where pt of x tilde h is equal to sum of p and beta stable pair invariants of x tilde, the small resolution, q n to t beta, such that push forward under this small resolution of the curved class is equal to 0. Remember that we have some x tilde to x, and we call this map h. It was to give it x 0. Push forward under the map of the curved classes that we consider on the x tilde, we want them to be 0. So this gives us some generating series, which appears on the denominator in here. This is the generating series of the smooth vibration. And what is this? This guy is the change of variable. This is the variable change. T to the beta goes to T to the epsilon tilde push forward of beta. And what was the epsilon tilde? This was, okay, so this was the, yeah, here. So we had this diagram that, so x tilde, x0 goes to x, goes down to c, this was pi tilde, epsilon, and then pi. Okay, so that's it. So this is our final theorem. So if you have nodal fibration by simultaneous, degenerations and so on, doing two degenerations, you can relate degenerations of some smooth fibration that you will get via a small resolution of a conifold, a threefold with conifold singularity. You can relate that to some intermediate object, some threefold, which I call XT. It was given by pulling back the threefold via ramification of the base curve along generic points of the base curve, and then by degenerating this intermediate object with xt, and then degenerating xt onto two copies of the original threefold, finds a relation between these two PT invariants. So this is a nice theorem that you proved. I didn't have time for this today to talk about perverse sheaves, small crossings, and so on, but I think this suffices, actually. Thank you so much. And I stop.
So are you going to talk about perverse sheaves in the end?
While
you finish.
At the very end? No, this lecture is.